Okay, so I finally got around to making a video on Caitlin Johnstone. Johnstone is one of these Jimmy Dore types, who, like Jimmy, build out a conspiracy narrative by hyper-focusing on a few cherry-picked facts, which sometimes aren't even facts, ignoring all facts, history, and reasoning that will disconfirm the theory she is peddling, and then sells this as contradicting the official narrative. In fact, Caitlin goes further and refers to this as the edge of the information matrix.
Notes from the edge of the narrative matrix.
Caitlin is a little different in that she writes her content onto Substack, and then has her husband, who sounds like an inebriated and annoyed version of Ben Stein, narrate this for YouTube. She then quotes herself on Twitter, and then said quote is retweeted by the portion of the echo chamber that exists on Twitter. Now, her statements are clever, and lend themselves perfectly to Twitter. The problem is that, while they are clever and fit neatly into 280 characters, they are vapid and rarely stand up to scrutiny. I'm reminded of a friend in college who found himself on this sort of mental journey. He was reading one book, which he believed explained all of the world's ills. As our group of friends got high, he would share his newfound wisdom, and he seemed amazed at his own brilliance in knowing these things. The problem, I knew, was that his narrative was all based on a few talking points, and ignored a wealth of disconfirming information. He had summited the western peak of Mount Dunning-Kruger, and he was damn proud of it. I didn't care, of course, because he was, and still is, my friend, and it was just a few of us smoking out, and talking nonsense. I also hadn't really formed any strong views for, or against his position. I just knew the reasoning he was using was flawed. But again, I didn't care. But I digress. Caitlin is very much like this friend. Except she's not some random 20-something just smoking out with a few friends. She has a following of people who think they're being red-pilled, and her ongoing gish gallop of quotable word salads, are all based on the same echo chamber talking points that Jimmy Dore inhabits. She also receives signal boosts from Jimmy and Russell Brand, who use people like Caitlin as a source. In reality, the people who are, unironically following people like Jimmy Dore, Russell Brand, and Caitlin are being taken for a ride, as their susceptibility to conspiracy theories is being exploited. As Stephen Novella, a clinical neurologist and host of The Skeptic's Guide to the Universe, states,
such as seeing an image or a face in an oil stain or the bark of a tree or a cloud. Well, conspiracy thinking is like pareidolia, but cognitively. It is seeing a pattern or hyperactive pattern detection in events that are occurring. Essentially, conspiracy theorists will connect the dots and see an invisible hand operating behind the scenes. Pattern recognition is also more common in response to feelings of powerlessness, supporting the notion that conspiracy thinking in part serves this emotional need. Even visual pareidolia becomes more likely in research scenarios where subjects are made to feel more powerless. Conspiracy thinking potentially meets other psychological needs as well, such as self-esteem. It may be a reaction to an inability to attain one's goals. It may, being part of an army of light, for example, offers not only self-esteem, but a way to channel feelings of anger.
It shouldn't be too surprising that Caitlin wrote a book titled The Complete Book of Astrology, Your Personal Guide to Learning, Understanding and Using Astrology. This video was originally going to include multiple Caitlin videos, but I decided to cut those other videos out for another time. So, let's get to it. Are you ready?
Here we go!
Fake political parties and a fake democracy. Notes from the edge of the narrative matrix. I remember feeling such solidarity with Democrats who opposed Bush's warmongering. I sincerely did not know it was just empty political posturing for them, and they'd happily sign off on any war, no matter how insane, as long as the president doing it had a D next to their name.
Okay, let's unpack this first talking point. It's clear from later in the video that the quote-unquote war that Democrats will apparently sign off on is the act of supplying Ukraine, a country under invasion, with weapons and humanitarian aid. It should be clear that one of these things is not like the other. In this case, Russia is playing the role the United States played in 2003. Furthermore, 55% of Democratic voters did support George W. Bush's war in Iraq, early on, when it was believed that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. That number would decline as the war dragged on and it was revealed that the American public had been lied to. Now, Did Democrats suddenly support the war in Iraq when Obama stepped into office? According to Pew Research, there was an uptick, but it was only 20% and then it began to fall from there. Oddly enough, support from independents also increased when he took office. Lastly, we did see a drawdown of troops under Obama. Full disclosure, I know this drawdown simply follows the timeline the Bush administration set, so I'm not saying Obama deserves a medal for this. The point is, that Democratic voters did see a withdrawal of total deployed troops under the president they voted for.
The US does not have political parties. It has narrative control ops disguised as political parties. One of them overtly promotes capitalism and imperialism by appealing to Americans' worst impulses. The other covertly diverts healthy impulses back into capitalism and imperialism.
Here's the thing, I can see how this unfalsifiable word salad makes sense to people whose understanding of politics is limited to this caricature fed to them in the Jimmy Dore echo chamber. This ongoing narrative of cherry-picked information, out-of-context clips or quotes, edited tweets and articles, and endless omissions of important information can easily lead one to fall for Caitlin's ongoing gish gallop of clever-sounding but ultimately meaningless statements.
An elephant and a donkey fight in a puppet show, and the crowd cheers for one or the other while thieves pick their pockets. And when people start to notice their wallets are missing, they're told they can stop the pickpocketing by cheering louder for their favorite puppet.
The irony here is that Caitlin's fabricated scenario works against her. The only time we've seen ambitious progressive policies pass through Congress is when the Democratic Party held overwhelming majorities in the Senate. We're talking 64% of the Senate when Social Security passed and 68% of the Senate when Medicare passed. Many progressive bills do make it through the House, which is representative of the electorate. It's in the Senate, where red states have a disproportionate advantage where they fail. When you've analyzed the big picture, and seen how and where bills fail, and are familiar with political history, caricatures like Caitlin's fall apart. However, by peddling a false narrative through cherry-picked facts, and by omitting the vast majority of relevant information, most of which contradicts the narrative they're peddling, they lead their audience through this alternate reality full of garbage conclusions. The irony is that the people in this echo chamber really believe that they've been red-pilled, and are privy to the reality of which the surrounding sheeple are blissfully unaware. For all the talk of being part of a blue team or a red team, there is no greater team loyalty than team conspiracy. Have you ever talked to these people? The moment you correct them on their history or add in some facts they were unaware of, all they have are hashtags or straw man arguments in response. Correct them on how much work went into trying to pass a bill and how much GOP obstruction went into opposing it, and their response is hashtag vote blue no matter who, or they accuse you of seeing the Democratic Party as some philanthropic venture. It reminds me of the old days of wearing down climate deniers and destroying all of their arguments to the point where all they can do is accuse you of peddling Al Gore's propaganda. The truth is, living in these echo chambers really does provide these people with a sense of comfort. To quote Alan Moore, "The main thing that I learned about conspiracy theory is that conspiracy theorists believe in a conspiracy because that is more comforting. The truth of the world is that it is actually chaotic. The truth is far more frightening. Nobody is in control. Believing that someone really is in control and pulling all of the strings provides a sense of comfort. The bad guy is easy to point out. All we have to do is replace said bad guy and everything will be fine. On top of that, let's be frank, it's easy to simply have all your information fed to you from a handful of sources that are pretty much in agreement. No need to do the hard thing and fact check them or at least compare what they're saying to those outside the echo chamber. Furthermore, there is a certain sense of self-esteem that comes with believing that you are one of the few that has seen the truth. As Stephen Novella, a clinical neurologist and host of The Skeptic's Guide to the Universe, states,
conspiracy thinking is a way to make sense of a complex or mysterious world. More likely when people feel that they lack control or are powerless or being victimized. Studies show that people who generally have a sense that they lack control over their lives or over their world are much more likely to engage in conspiracy thinking. In fact, we often lack detailed information about important political events or other events that occur throughout the world. This opens the door even further to conspiracy thinking because we can fill the gaps in our knowledge with ideas or notions that are comforting or useful in some way. Conspiracy thinking offers the illusion of certainty. In this way, it's very much like superstitious thinking, which provides the illusion of control. Therefore, these two types of thinking meet a basic psychological need. One of the forms of thinking that is inherent to conspiracy thinking is pattern recognition. A conspiracy theory is often just that. It is a pattern. In this case, it's a pattern imposed upon disconnected events. You may recall that we discussed pareidolia, the tendency of our brain to impose patterns on random data, such as seeing an image or a face in an oil stain or the bark of a tree or a cloud. Well, conspiracy thinking is like pareidolia, but cognitively. It is seeing a pattern or hyperactive pattern detection in events that are occurring. Essentially, conspiracy theorists will connect the dots and see an invisible hand operating behind the scenes. Pattern recognition is also more common in response to feelings of powerlessness, supporting the notion that conspiracy thinking in part serves this emotional need. Even visual pareidolia becomes more likely in research scenarios where subjects are made to feel more powerless. Conspiracy thinking potentially meets other psychological needs as well, such as self-esteem. It may be a reaction to an inability to attain one's goals. It may, being part of an army of light, for example, offers not only self-esteem, but a way to channel feelings of anger. Thank you.